The next speaker for the session is Mr. V.N. Prem Anand, Life Member and Secretary, Cybersecurity of India. He has over 27 years experience in the information technology space, engineering management, training, consultancy, and research. This includes hands-on experience in cybersecurity, CSR advisory, digital skills for board, leadership skills, software architecture, project management, and constraint management. He is one among three fellow engineers registered with Society of Professional Engineers, UK from India. He has experience in providing technology platform for telemedicine, including government projects. One such project is in Tripura with Central Hospital at Agartala connected to 41 rural centers. Please welcome him on the stage.
Thank you and good morning to everybody. Good morning. Thank you. So I'm going to touch upon some points about cybersecurity in the enterprise and beyond that. So what do we have today? Today's technology is evolving and we have opportunities and challenges in increasing. We are at a stage where we have our society with lots of internet access and coming age of automation, big data, and IoT. This is a new age. Our lives are today absolutely codified by data in almost every activity we involve in. We have data with internet, we have data on our phones, we have data on our other devices, we have data on industrial devices. So, can we imagine a world without cybersecurity? One of the most damaging targets for a society is cyber warfare and its impact on infrastructure. Our reliance on automation focuses on single point failures, which is not limited. It can have dramatic consequences if it is directed at very specific installations like power stations, communication network, transport, or other utilities. So what do? We have to maintain an accurate inventory of control system devices. We should have a policy of not to allow any machine on control network to talk directly to the outside world. Many organizations have industrial control systems that may not directly face the internet. For example, the SCADA systems, but the threats are always there. Now, talking about implementing network segmentation and applying firewalls, you know already most of the connected networks are using firewalls. So we have to classify according to IT assets, devices, whether it belongs to the company's data, personal, or specific group, and restrict them to different groups. What do we have as an advantage is by placing different resources in different areas of a network, we can avoid one device compromisation which will result in exploitation of the whole system. Then coming to secure remote access method, we have lots of devices, lots of control systems in our companies and infrastructure. Employees are working inside and also from outside. The ability to remote connect to a network has added a great deal of convenience. At the same time, brings in lots of threats. So VPN is already in use by many companies. A VPN is an encrypted channel wherein we have securely sending devices, receiving data through a public infrastructure like internet. Role-based access controls are very important. This goes a long way in protecting your networks. Role-based access controls grants or denies access to specific resources based on specific functions. This also limits the ability of individual users to reach particular places of files which are very important and which are also vulnerable. For example, SCADA systems, normally the SCADA systems are kept separately, but nevertheless, there is some single point from outside where somebody can enter into this network by some compromise. For example, social engineering. If some hacker wants to come into the system, he can always not exploit the system vulnerabilities, but also look at some employee vulnerabilities and coming through the social network and then making the system vulnerable. Of course, passwords, many other speakers previously would have spoken about it. I would just like to emphasize on certain points. Use strong passwords. Always change default passwords that come with any hardware or software systems. Hackers can easily try and break by having lots of combinations and then make a brute force attack. We have to maintain awareness of vulnerabilities across the organization. Most vendors work diligently to develop patches and identify vulnerabilities. Any release patches have to be updated immediately. To protect ourselves from opportunistic attacks, a system of monitoring for applying system patches across the network should be implemented. Policies. We have laptops, tablets, smartphones, and other mobile devices in our workplace. So mobile nature of these devices brings potentially a lot of external compromises. Contributing to this challenge is the increasing trend of organization allowing employees to bring their own devices, known as BYOD. Employee cybersecurity training program is essential. Cybersecurity has become an ongoing talent development program. For critical infrastructure sectors that operate on industrial control systems, like SCADA and other systems, water and waste management sector, it is extremely important. It is an expansive field, nevertheless, and for general awareness, one should always keep looking for new topics, learn, and topic like social engineering, which continues to be a popular means of cyber criminals getting into unsuspecting employees, because it is not only a network, it is also the awareness among the employees to look for vulnerabilities and keeping themselves protected against this from outside. So organizations are also elevating executives to the role of CISO. This position, of course, has yet to achieve a level of respect and acceptance because there are not many case studies which talks about absolutely protecting a network in terms of damage. Measures for detecting compromises. Many penetrative measures organizations implement may still have compromises. Experts have noted it's not a question of if, but more of a question of when it will happen. A compromise occurs, the organizations are fair. Best will be those that quickly respond to the system. Here, I would like to highlight a term called AI. Many organizations have started using AI. People think it is artificial intelligence, but I slightly differ in that context to call it augmented intelligence, because total AI cannot be done by a system. The system, though, is able to read a log of 20,000 records in a matter of seconds compared to a human being who will take almost a day or two to go through those records. It gives an absolutely concise information in terms of an AI, but nevertheless you need a human intervention to see whether there are some false positives in the log and then come up with a greater evaluation and put it in the knowledge base and use it as a defense mechanism for the next threat. Beyond the basics, we have ongoing evolution of tactics in intrusion attempts, and deploying advanced system security provides defense at every network access point. So intelligent security fences have to be kept and which will impede breaches and isolate threats. Coming to advanced system security, barriers have to be at access points that are keep intruders off the network. We choose to use the term network access point defense here rather than perimeter, because the perimeter is slowly disappearing today with more and more interconnected devices. environment which are interconnected are susceptible to threats. For example, a provider or a payer's secured network can extend far beyond the perimeter to include elements that are responsibility of suppliers, contractors, and many other stakeholders. So what do we have? 96% of all security incidents fall into these basic patterns. Point of sale intrusions, crimeware, cyber espionage, insider misuse, web attacks, application attacks, miscellaneous errors, physical theft, loss, payment card skimmers, and denial of service. Widening the array of network access points, we have examples of electronic medical records that are being maintained in the healthcare space. Then we have third-party vendors, supply chain vendors coming into the ecosystem, employee-facing access points, including their own devices, links that are connected to data centers via the cloud, which is outside, maybe outside the country, links to insurance companies, financial institutions, and payment processors, and linked to many other service providers. Healthcare and government public health system are more vulnerable. We have other contractors who provide network access, B2B, intranet, extranet portals, wireless routers, patient kiosks. This is specific to healthcare, expanding Internet of Things, and other devices which are like surveillance cameras. Protecting valuables inside the enterprise. So if we implement a proper mechanism of defense, network access points can be kept away from intruders. But there still there will be intrusion attempts that make their way past the defenses. So what do? We have to keep the second level of defense much more protected. So in terms of healthcare organizations, they have more data that must be shared with other hospitals and other networks. So these network organizations, along with number of endpoints, have great security challenges. So again, I'm saying using AI as a weapon, access point and data specific safeguards, use analytics to keep and watch for patterns that could indicate there is an intruder in the system, and to issue alerts, counteractions that can be taken quickly. Normally, threats, when they happen, they do not happen suddenly. It is almost something like 7 months in advance it starts. Effective process controls should be in place. Once network access defenses and analytics are in place, then we have to keep the system updated and maintaining strengthening of process controls. Security must also include human element. As I insisted, the augmented intelligence, where the artificial intelligence system that are built by cybersecurity experts along with hardware software tools are used to collect the logs, infer various information, and then give it to a human expert who will also analyze, put his inputs, and build the knowledge base which will be kept for the next threat to be handled. Learning from experience of others, talking to other CISOs, networks, and keeping an update of what is happening in the industry and keeping the system updated. Here I would like to emphasize another point. The hackers are more networked than the CISOs. Across industries, looking from outside, there's a lot going on in the information security. Risk here, governance there, cyber everywhere. So they are overripe headlines. Now we come to specific industries, energy and utilities, oil and gas. So everyone knows energy and utility companies are prime targets. Fortunately, unlike other financial institutions like bank or, you know, insurance companies, the SCADA systems generally are kept in a separate environment. Still, there are about security maturity in the industry. There are always room for improvement, and one single point which can connect the SCADA system to the outside world can bring down the whole network. Oil and gas may not seem like an industry that hackers would target, but they have done so in the past so many years. right from 2008, there are lots of cases that are being published in the internet. The cybersecurity risks arise with every new database link between rigs, refineries, and headquarters. Increasingly connected world, ONG companies need to protect themselves. Risks and stakes. Cyber attacks have been targeted crude oil and natural gas companies, growing in frequency, but industry cyber maturity is relatively low, and ONG boards have generally shown limited strategic appreciation of cyber issues. But after 2010, this has been taken very seriously by the top management in the ONG. Why this is so? Because the industry engaged in exploration, development, production of crude oil may simply feel like an unlikely target for the normal public. The business is about barrels, not bytes. But with motives of hackers fast evolving, they range from cyber terrorism to, you know, government espionage and industry espionage, so it is growing fast. Digitization magnifies the challenges. Apart from upstream industry critical infrastructure status, a complex ecosystem of computation, networking, and physical operational process makes the cyber attacks more frequent. We have several attack vectors ranging from pop-up, Windows, web pages, and whatnot. Complexity brings complexity. In contrast to IT systems such as enterprise resource planning, here the reverse priority of confidentiality, integrity, and availability. This clash of objectives is always there, safety versus security. Engineers fear that stringent IT security measures could introduce unacceptable latency. Attacks, it is no surprise that pinpointing attackers is very tough. A huge attack on a Saudi Arabian oil and gas installation happened in 2012. The attackers were never identified. So safeguarding ONG sector has been proved of most important. Specifically, cyber attack in the ONG may lead to plant shutdown and even loss of lives. Several high-profile attacks, including the 2012 Saudi Aramco attack, which unleashed a virus, a simple virus, which affected 30,000 or more workstations in the company, and the whole network went down. What happened? Someone opened a spam mail, clicked on a wrong link. In a few hours, 30,000 computers partially wiped out. Company went back to typewriters and faxes, stopped selling for a while, and gave free oil to domestic clients because they were not able to process the request, and quickly replaced computers. Global impact: hard disk drives became costly during 2012 and 13, between September 2012 and January 13 to be exact. Smaller company like this would have wound up. Hackers were not caught. Major hacks that happen in ONG. 2008, hackers interfered with alarms and communications in Turkey. 2010, Stuxnet. Stuxnet is a software, you know, which is used to read specific nuclear installations, but they don't affect other networks. 2012 cyber attack on Aramco. 2012 another RasGas Limited, which was infected by virus in Qatar, and there is a malware flame which spreads like anything, which affected some of the telecom industry, which uses some software to record audio screenshots and user activity. So we have this slide on IoT maturity. Talks about information value loop, stages and drivers, maturity of upstream, maturity of ONG industry. Complication: technical setup of ICS also carries inherent security challenges. So decade plus life cycle of wells and ICS system, ongoing asset sales and purchases add to the diversity of the problem, because there are many vendors, many decision makers. So how to mitigate cyber security risk? First step, forming risk mitigation strategies. All too common response when it comes to mitigating cyber risks. And then to be more resilient and have a proper plan, companies should focus equally on gaining more insight into threats and responding more effectively. So we have exploration, development, and production. In exploration, malware enters through network storage needs to steal competitive seismic data. So we have to do some tokenizing. What is tokenizing? Masking the actual data by putting an alternate. And then keeping and monitoring discipline level network traffic, setting up a cluster-based backup architecture for multiple storage nodes. In the development, a rogue program deployed on rig starts governing drill parameters and essentially ends up with a well deviation. So this can be stopped by having some cross-discipline cyber playbook for on-site and off-site people. In production, a masked worm in a SCADA system can change speed of a motor pumps randomly and leading to suboptimal production and eventually damaging wells. So we have to be very careful, improve cyber judgment and response through cyber war gaming and simulations. So we have the top 10 practices here. Build a risk-aware culture. Establish intelligent security operations and rapid threat response. Develop security-rich products by design. Manage information technology department hygienically. Create security-rich and resilient network. Address security complexity of cloud and virtualization techniques. You have to be doubly careful when you deploy any application on the cloud which is outside your campus. Manage third-party security compliance. Have a system in place with all your stakeholders, whether it be vendors, your subcontractors, your clients, and share your security policy with them. And also try to do an audit of systems that are directly connected to your office. For example, we may have an oil and gas exploration unit where you could have the vendors connected. You could have your finance system separately connected to them through a different network which may be not connected to the exploration unit. Assure data security and privacy, which is very important. And most important of all, have regular cybersecurity training programs, short workshops organized internally at frequent intervals of time for all your key employees who are operating the managed assets. Manage the digital identity lifecycle. And finally, use augmented intelligence along with your artificial intelligence tools to the maximum extent to build cyber defenses and also a knowledge base of cyber threats and how it was resolved. This will help in managing future threats. So rather than having a knee-jerk reaction or acting when it happens, have a mechanism if and whenever it happens. So that will protect your network. Thank you.
How was it?
It was a good term.
Yeah? Good to meet you. Thank you.